There's a point in the course of your life as a sheltered American, if you study film anyway, where you realize just how few non-American films you've seen. Hollywood is omnipresent and makes itself out to be the only game in town, and for many Americans it is. While general film literacy is probably the highest on average it's ever been, especially now that academics have discovered that their field becomes far more accessible once you make it entertaining, this fact belies just how shallow our appreciation for the medium can be. I grew up on a weird mix of 90s contemporary action films like The Matrix and Spy Kids, and 1950s B-movies like The Fly and Forbidden Planet. In any given group of friends, I was the one who knew the most about film, especially after Wikipedia became a thing. I was the teenager who loved Citizen Kane, who rewatched the likes of Gone with the Wind and Ben-Hur almost like I was determined to become the most stereotypically white film school undergrad in the history of cinema studies. Well, that is to say that I considered myself a very film-literate person, but if you had told me 10 years ago that I would one day obsess over the softcore Marxist pornography of Koji Wakamatsu or the themed anthologies of Krzysztof Kieslowski, I probably would have said, wait, they make movies in other countries? I was aware of international cinema, names like Akira Kurosawa and Jean-Luc Godard, but I, in my naivete, thought somehow these were one-off creators, exceptions to the rule that most movies are made in America. It wasn't that I had a hard and fast opinion on the subject, I just never really thought about it. Like, I only ever see Hollywood movies, so that means most movies are made in Hollywood, right? It's like if for your entire life you've only ever eaten hamburgers. Yeah, they're good. Maybe they're even your favorite food, and maybe you say it's the best food there is. But until you've had Korean, Brazilian, German, Mexican, or Chinese food, how can you possibly know that hamburgers are the best? Watching international cinema for the first time can be tough, because there's just so much you don't know that the film probably takes for granted. Things like regional history, regional humor, regional street wisdom, and all of that can be compounded if the film has a bad translation. Puns or play on words have to be reconsidered for an audience that probably doesn't understand what the flavor of green tea over rice means. And while your Criterions, Arrows, and Kinos do a pretty serviceable job, the vast majority of international cinema can only be understood here in the US through spotty fan subs. It also doesn't help that Hollywood filmmaking is monolithic and leaves very little room for experimentation. Unless you were an auteur in the 90s. Which means that the average American's film vocabulary is limited to the point that equally valid alternatives to standard Hollywood practices are viewed instead as flaws or mistakes. I've heard many a young white film scholar, in an echo of my own youthful ignorance, berate Breathless because, jump cuts are bad. No! That was a stylistic choice! There are better reasons to dislike Breathless. What being a student of film means to me is not taking your first reaction as a final critical opinion. After all, some of the best films are only good after you've seen them more than once. Blade Runner. Cough, cough, cough. So here's a for instance. On a lark, I picked up Criterion's recent release of Ousmane Sembene's Black Girl. I'd never heard of the film or the director, but I find that if I were to stick to my natural tastes, I'd never see any good movies. So I watched it, and at 55 minutes, it was unusually easy to slip into my schedule for a Criterion release.
Touch of Zen. New World Director's Cut. Brighter Summer Day, Fanny and Alexander.
When am I supposed to watch these?
Black Girl is the story of Diawana, a young woman living in the slums of Senegal. One day, an affluent French family offers her a job as a maid and they fly her to France to live with them, and Diawana gives them the gift of a tribal mask she bought from a child in her hometown as an expression of cultural exchange. Diawana expects an exciting nightlife in the high fashion of Paris, but instead finds that her employers expect her to do everything from cooking meals to cleaning house and is never given a break. When friends come over for dinner, Diawana silently watches as all the white people in the room remark about how good of a cook she is, how pretty she is for a black girl, and how much she stands out from the rest of her like. As if that particular objectification wasn't already enough, this happens.
Ah. Vous permettez, mademoiselle? Je n'ai jamais embrassé une négresse.
J'ai l'impression qu'elle n'est pas contente.
Diawana grows depressed, despondent, and rebellious to her screaming employers. She throws her paycheck at the feet of her hosts, packs her bag, and defiantly commits suicide in their bathtub, like a reasonable adult. The husband later takes her few possessions back to Senegal in the hopes of paying her family for her work, but they also refuse the payment. The child who Diawana bought the mask from takes the mask back and menacingly tails the husband all the way back to the airport, where the film ends on this shot of the boy slowly revealing his face. My immediate impression was... It wasn't that I thought Black Girl was bad by any means, just not particularly remarkable. The casting choices and the visual style clearly took inspiration from Italian neorealism, but the result felt less expressive than claustrophobic, as if the filmmakers were limited by the walls of their set. It's clearly a subversive film that comes from a very personal place, but it takes the very French New Wave approach of leaving it to the audience's interpretation, which can be great when done well, but usually results in a film that feels locked off from any kind of relationship with its subject, which makes it hard to care about what you're seeing. And then there's the fact that Diawana commits suicide, which... The optics of a black female-led film ending with that character's death aren't great, even if it works in the context of this film. This isn't really a criticism of the film so much as it is just personal preference on my part, but I just really don't like it when characters commit suicide in a film. It can feel like an easy way to get out of a situation or sort of wrap up your screenplay, and that's definitely not the case here, but it's made worse by the feeling that, like, she could have left, right? She could have taken the money she was offered and, like, bought a plane ticket home or found somewhere more supporting to live, or... I recognize that this isn't a particularly useful criticism of any film, but it's a reaction you have when you lack context. Maybe that wad of money wasn't worth as much as I'd assume, and maybe 1960s France really hated Africans, so going somewhere else wasn't an option, but as an ignorant American 60 years removed from the film's release, I simply don't know these things and can't help but fill that vacuum of knowledge with my own cultural context. But all of that aside, I was just kind of bored, which is ultimately the first and last sin of any film. I could certainly see its historical significance, but as a film on the merits of the work as it stands today, it just didn't click with me. So that's my first reaction, right? After finishing the film, I could have gotten mad about how it wasted my time and written a grumpy blog post about how old movies are overrated. Instead of doing that, I decided to watch the special features and do some reading, because I figured, hey, this movie probably got a Criterion release and won a bunch of awards for a reason. You know, that doesn't usually happen for subpar films, unless you're... at the Oscars. What I learned then is that the French government in colonial Senegal outlawed citizens of the African nation from making films because they knew of the revolutionary potential of the medium. As such, Black Girl in 1966 was the first film produced in Senegal that was written and directed by someone from Senegal, Ousmane Sembene. Sembene himself fought in World War II and wrote numerous books, the strength of which got him into the Soviet Union to study film when French film endowments turned him down. He became a lifelong communist who participated in multiple strikes and unionization efforts, which is reflected in his art. The film itself is inspired by a moment in Sembene's own life when he was on the beach in France and saw locals reading a paper with the headline story of a black girl who had been found dead in a bathtub. The scene was powerful enough that Sembene wrote a story about it, which he then adapted into a film. It turns out that at-arm's-length cinematography is a deliberate choice to emphasize a plurality of people, as Sembene was less interested in the individual than the group. He intended Black Girl as a parable about French attempts to dilute African culture and take advantage of its poorest citizens, and the ways that those in Senegal could take their power back. The mask is meant as an embodiment of spiritual heritage, which when hung on a wall becomes only a trinket, but when hung on a black face becomes a force to be feared, a symbolic representation of a culture pushing back against colonialism. In short, Black Girl is a film that actively protested against cultural appropriation long before that term even existed. Armed with this knowledge, Black Girl becomes an entirely different film. Those stylistic choices, which felt at first lazy and uninspired, are revealed to be very measured and thoughtful. On a second viewing, equipped now with the context of the film's release, Black Girl's actual message becomes clear in every frame. To say the least, I was never bored. And if I had stuck to my first impression, I would have carried with me a version of Black Girl which is simply incorrect. Context is everything in cinema. If you dislike or don't understand a film, take a second to research the culture around it. You might be surprised by how much this can change a film. And none of which is to say that you're not entitled to your first impression. Like, a bad movie's a bad movie, but sometimes, maybe you just don't have all the information you need. So go watch a bunch of movies from different countries, expand your vocabulary, try new things, get out of your comfort zone. The varieties of cinematic experience available to you are beyond measure. Look, hamburgers are great, don't get me wrong, but this world is too big and our lives are too short to have never eaten anything else.